Hello, hello. So here is a link to Marie Cachet's archived video. Advise you when it gets to the end of the video, and there's a link to what used to be her website. Don't follow it, it doesn't exist anymore. The domain has been taken over by someone who's up to mischief. This is the theory that I'm responding to, the theory of Varg and Marie, and people who follow either or both of them will know that that's what I was referencing in my Varg teaser, as I called it. So now that you've watched it, if you haven't watched it, go watch it quickly and then come back here and resume. You'll see she mentions a few of the things that I've noted in my previous videos. She notes that the Mysterian tool culture was more advanced than the superseding Homo sapiens cultures were for another 10 or 20,000 years. She also mentions the cranial size and the problem that Neanderthals will no doubt have encountered in having babies with Homo sapiens, particularly if it was a Neanderthal male and human female, although I would think it was more the other way around. But we'll get into that at some point. I'm going to make a full playlist of videos about Neanderthal. I'm going to start talking about archaic hominids in general. And I'm going to put it at the front of an archaic hominids playlist and at the front of this Neanderthal playlist I'm working on. But I just wanted to direct you to the video and to make a few notes first. So the way Marie addresses the slight problem her theory has, whereby our crania are very obviously altered from a Neanderthal form towards a sapiens form is, I will talk about this in more depth, but the reason ours are more similar to theirs is because of this minimal admixture and because of this problem with those of more typical Neanderthal crania being able to be born, because the Homo sapiens has a very narrow hip bone structure, and you see it still if you compare European and African hip bone structures, or even different phenotypes within Europe. You see that some are more typically sapiens, they have very a narrow structure, and some have the wider wider hips, and also the barrel-shaped rib cage. Now, something that's really cool about this video is that she's actually referenced various SNPs single nucleotide polymorphisms. It's variations in a gene that we give names to. But she gives the code for these in Neanderthals for various genes that were present in Neanderthals that are not in humans, and she gives the function as well. So there are a lot of genes to do with brain development and the nervous system, sight, hearing, and also the male reproductive organs and the male sex cells, the gametes, and which is not surprising because it doesn't seem like any of the male Y DNA has survived, but the male X DNA definitely has, which I'll get on to, I'll show you. But I mean, her theory must hold if she's saying 99.7% that certain clades belong to the Neanderthals, certain clades of Y as well, otherwise it's very strange that she should quote such a high figure. But yeah, I couldn't find any info about these SNPs, which is unfortunate. I will look into it in future, and I'll give you an update once I've managed to garner some more information. But it's not surprising that they would have different genes regarding brain development. There are a lot of different genes that code for greater brain development and higher intelligence. The things are often closely linked. And they had much larger crania by average, so it's not surprising. They also had a very different shape of inner ear, and they had various other ganglion and bits of skeletal variation that are still present in modern-day Europeans, which is a very interesting thing to mention. Again, it's something I'll come on to later. So that's it for today. I hope you enjoyed Marie's video, and I hope you enjoyed this video, and I hope you're excited for the rest of the Neanderthal videos to come. Ciao for now.